grabbed the wrong transmitter. All righty. It's time to get started for Sunday school time. And we are live going out over the internet here from Second Baptist Church on this, what is today, the 13th day of September already. And good to see your faces today. My brother Wade Lackey has our lesson for us. So I'm going to call Wade to come and help us out. And help us see some good stuff about God this morning. Got a good lesson. Good lesson.
Thank you. Welcome. Good morning. It's always appropriate in anything, especially when we're in God's house, to pray as well. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day. We thank you for this opportunity for us to come to your house. We thank you that we still live in a country where we freely get up, come to your house, and study your word, Lord, and as we go through this. Let my words be guided by the Holy Spirit. Let each person here be open and receptive to your words, Lord, that they might adjust their life to be more like Jesus and may have some come to Jesus this morning. Jesus Christ, in the name of the Lord. I'm going to be bringing a lesson from the youth curriculum that is same scripture as the adult curriculum. Probably a little bit different commentary, maybe geared a little bit more to the youth than the adults, but I thought it would be appropriate nonetheless for the entire group. Our lesson this morning is entitled The Endurance of Our Hope. And the question is, when has your endurance really been tested? We're going to look at 1 Peter chapter 3, verses 8 through 17 as we get into the lesson. A little bit of commentary. It says, we can be confident in our salvation when we, as a matter of desire, live in obedience to God and in what that reflects, in ways that reflects Jesus. Jesus told his followers that we will suffer in this life, generally because of sin's curse, and specifically for following him. Trials reveal the truth about our faith. If we turn away from Jesus when life gets hard, then we know that our faith isn't genuine. However, if we press on in following Christ because of our love for him, then we know that our eternal salvation is secure. And the first point of my message this morning is these things that we're talking about and the hope that we have in Jesus Christ. You are not going to have that hope if you have not given your life to Jesus Christ. So this morning, as you listen to these words, as you listen to Brother Steve's message, search deep and understand and know your salvation. Either you need salvation or you have salvation. And that's something that I would encourage you to take care of before you leave this morning. We'll have a break. Our intermission. Grab one of our church leaders and talk to them, or we'll have an invitation at the end of our service. Because what we're discussing today, you're not going to be able to enjoy those benefits of Jesus Christ unless you accept him into your life. Got a little short video that I think is very appropriate, and she has that ready. I'll just move it out of the way. It takes a little less than 2 minutes.
Child has a special need. It isn't going away anytime soon, no matter how much you name and claim. When you go to that next doctor's appointment and the cancer is worse, not better. When that relational hurt is not healing. When that grief over loss is not going away. When you see no light at the end of that dark tunnel, God says, in the middle of a real world where these are realities, God says, trust in me. Even when you can't see it, I have good plans for you. Light is coming. In this fallen, hurting world, weeping may tarry for the night, but God guarantees joy is coming in the morning. And God not only guarantees that suffering will eventually come to an end, God promises to get you to that end. God's plan calls for patient trust, and God's plan comes with persevering grace. Remember the language in Jeremiah 29 here. I will restore you. I will gather you. I will bring you back from this place. God doesn't say you're on your own in your suffering. Hopefully you can make it through this. No, God says you're in my hands. And I take responsibility for bringing you through your suffering, which means I'm going to give you all the grace, all the strength, all the wisdom, all the help you need.
And a lot of times where I find it confusing, because other scriptures in God's Word talks about Him always providing for us, Him never leaving us, Him never forsaking us, Him blessing us in times of our obedience. So all of that happens in our lifetime. Yes, God is going to bless us here on this earth and also in heaven for the works that we do for Him, for the kindness that we show to other people. But the scriptures that we're going to read today demonstrate that He is also going to allow us to go through some troubles. He's going to allow us to go through some persecution. And our protection as Christians, our protection is because we belong to Jesus Christ, is that He's going to give us peace, He's going to give us hope, He's going to give us even joy in times of whatever problems we're going through. And that should excite us as Christians, but that should also prepare us to know that, hey, those times are going to hit. Those troubles are going to come. We're not exempt from that. If He allowed Jesus Christ to go through what He went through, from the time that He was gathered up by those soldiers and He was spat on, beaten, mocked, why should we as Christians expect Him to treat us any different or exempt us from any of that? And do I completely understand that? No, I don't. But Scripture is going to help us walk through that a little bit this morning and help us to understand that a little bit. So I'm going to be reading from 1 Peter 3, verses 8 through 12. I think Steve and I decided this was the CSV version, so we're going to put that up on the screen. It may not be exactly the version that you're coming from this morning. Finally, all of you be like-minded and sympathetic, love one another, and be compassionate and humble, not paying back evil for evil or insults for insults, but on the contrary, giving a blessing since you were called for this, so that you may inherit a blessing from the one who wants to love life and see good days. Let him keep his tongue from evil and his lips from speaking deceit. And let him turn away from evil and do what is good. Let him seek peace and pursue it, because the eyes of the Lord are on the righteous and his ears are open to their prayer. But the face of the Lord is against those who do what is evil. You know, we talk a lot on Wednesday nights in our youth group about our perception. My perception when I'm at work. Their perception when they're in the halls, in the classroom of their schools. I tell them, as I point it back towards me, our response as Christians to things that happen should be different than the world's. When we talk about being holy and holiness, what holiness means is being set apart from the world. And when we have troubles and trials, and as Christians we don't act any different than what the world does, that kills our testimony. When we hit hard times, when we have people ridicule us, persecute us, and we respond in a way that we either ignore it, accept it, or show them love when they showed us evil, and that shows us like Jesus Christ. Is that easy to do? Maybe some of the hardest times in our lives to show respect, show love, show Jesus to people that would like to see us fired, would like to see us lose everything that we have, would like to literally spit in my face. But I don't see anything Jesus did when he walked the earth that was easy to eat. And that is our same goal. That is what we're called to do, is to walk as closely on this earth as Jesus did. So the first thing in those group of scriptures talks about unity. The command to be like-minded isn't referring to minor details, but rather to unity on major points of faith. Believers reflect their devotion to God, not in uniformity, but in unity. We should stop being upset over minor issues. Instead, we should concentrate on Jesus and what we have in common with other brothers and sisters in Christ. And, you know, I'm far away from speaking much on politics, but we are in a political atmosphere those words there about unity is very true, that we don't need to worry about the minor details. We need to worry about the truth. Where do we find the truth? That truth is in God's Word. And Scripture tells us what's right. Scripture tells us what's wrong. And Scripture tells us how we should vote this November. Mutual concern is to be sympathetic. It means to have compassion or to feel with others. Deal with others, even to the point of being willing to suffer together. This relates not only to sorrow, but all of life's experiences. We rejoice with those who rejoice, just as we weep with those who weep, as our concern for others ultimately outweighs the concern for self. And if you've been alive for very long and you've experienced relationships and people, you find out who your real true friends are when you hit tough times, don't you? All those friends, when things are good, and we have money and we can meet together and go out together, whatever it is, got lots of friends. But when tough times hit, and those friends, they stop calling and checking on us. They stop answering the phone. We seem to be distant. And us as Christians are supposed to be there for people. It does say in times of good, but also in those times of sorrow. Need Jesus the worst. We need to be that light. We need to show them Jesus whenever they're going through those things. The next one is love. Peter employed the Greek word philadelphos, which refers specifically to brotherly love, to convey Christians' responsibility to love one another as members of God's family. We reflect our love for Christ and how we love our spiritual brothers and sisters. The next one's compassion. Live in a world where people are naturally self-centered, insensitive, and very cynical. The church should be quite different, a place of compassion where the err on the side of grace and do too much rather than not enough. Jesus modeled this through his tender, genuine misery of people. And as a church, we're going to have people to come through our doors that don't look like us, that talk like us, and we're to love them, we're to accept them, we are to show them love, compassion. Because I'm going to tell you right now, I've been in a place in my life that I needed compassion. I needed Jesus. But first, it seemed like the compassion from others, other Christians, is what helped bring me back to Jesus. We need to be that light. There, when you see someone stumble, see them fall, instead of ignoring them, laughing at them, or mocking them, even if what they brought on themselves is totally from themselves, we have to be different. Humility. Peter knew Christians must have a realistic view of themselves. We measure ourselves by Christ's holiness, and there's absolutely no room for boasting or pride. Worldly people, when they criticize or when others receive honor, will be defensive or angry. But Christians will behave like Jesus, who remain humble and quiet when people mistreat them. Me trying to put somebody else's light out doesn't make my life any brighter. And even if it did, I'm not supposed to anyway. We need to congratulate those when they do well, when they finish strong. Even if it's a small win, encourage those people when they need encouragement. And when we have wins, we need to be humble about that. We need to express how God has blessed us, but also we need to show humility. Forgiveness. This may be the toughest in the list. Grief. An unforgiving spirit will damage relationships, destroy joy, and ultimately send roots of bitterness deep into the heart. When others offend us, even in terrible ways, refusing forgiveness makes the wounds even worse. Peter urged the church to respond in a way that only God can empower. Repaying evil with a blessing, we have been redeemed and forgiven by God, and we should offer the same forgiveness to those who have wronged us. Well, that is not what the world tells us, is it? Eye for an eye. We're going to, they did this to us, we're going to come back 3 times harder. There are times when we stand up for injustices, guys. There are times that we stand up for those who can't stand up for themselves. But when we as Christians are going through persecution, we need to count it as Jesus allowing, God allowing us to go through those things and to just forgive them because they don't have the mind of Christ. How can they really, really know what's right or wrong if they don't have the mind of Christ? 1 Peter 3, verses 13 and 14 will be our next group of scripture. Who then will harm you if you are devoted to what is good? But even if you should suffer for righteousness, you are blessed. Do not fear what they fear or be intimidated. When we do things God calls us to do, the world will not necessarily appreciate it. We will experience times of unjust suffering. Sometimes it's because we stood up for what's right. Maybe we've spoken up for someone. People were picking on, and they were giving you a hard time because of your commitment to purity. Whatever the case, when life is unfair and difficult, because of our obedience to God, our hope in Jesus always carries through even the most difficult circumstances. So as I try to digest this, rationalize this, Scriptures tell me personally that the deeper my relationship is with Jesus Christ, the more peaceful I'm going to be able to live life through tough times. And as mature Christians, we're even going to be able to unimaginably experience joy in tough times. And that doesn't make sense at all. But we cannot understand the mind of God and how God works. But He can allow us, if we're connected close to Him, to experience that. Now, God has the power immediately to fix anything in our life. He can do it in a split minute second. But He does not always do that. I'll probably say He seldom does that. So what we're to learn from that is that God will answer our righteous prayer, but it will be in His time. And I've talked to some very experienced, mature Christians that still can't give answers to why things happen, except for, in the end, it's going to be God's will. And that's something here on earth we very possibly will never completely understand. And I think it's designed that way. Because if we, where would we have faith? Faith wouldn't exist if God immediately answered our prayers exactly the way we wanted to, and He never made us wait on anything. So that's where our faith comes into play. Because that's what God wants from us. He wants us to have faith in those times that we can't see Him. Faith, especially in those times that we can't see an end to what we're praying to. not easy, but it is what we're called to do. Our last group of scriptures here is 1 Peter 3:15-17. But in your hearts, regard Christ, the Lord is holy, ready at any time to give a defense to anyone who asks for a reason for the hope that is in you. Yet do this with gentleness and respect, keeping a clear conscience, so that when you are accused, those who disparage your good conduct in Christ will be put to shame. For it is better to suffer for doing good, if that should be God's will, than for doing evil. That scripture doesn't give a timeline either, does it? But it does most definitely state what God will do, what He will do for us as Christians, as long as we continue the good fight, as long as we continue to trust Him through those times that are tough, times that feel like that we're hopeless. As Christians, are we ever truly hopeless? Always have the hope of Jesus Christ. We are not designed, pay close attention, we are not designed to be defeated. We're not designed to live in a state of fear, a state of anxiety. We're not built that way. And if we truly are Christians and we're living that way, then we're saying that those problems, those things are bigger than our God. And if you're saying that, you're wrong. God is in control of our lives. He's in control of our nation. He's in control of the whole world. Most days, can we physically see that? No. That's where our faith comes in. And that's where we as Christians have to tell our testimony every day. We have to stand up for those that can't stand up for themselves. God's scripture just told us that we have to expect some persecution. We have to expect some hard times. Times that's not going to be warm and fuzzy. Sometimes that may challenge way that we think, because a lot of the way we think is from the world. This last group of scriptures focuses on two different things. The first one is holiness. Peter recognized that if believers would view Christ as holy in their hearts, we wouldn't worry about what other people thought, and we would not be intimidated. Instead, we would serve as bold witnesses to the life-changing power of the gospel. Holiness has to come first. There's no way we'll ever be ready to boldly proclaim Jesus or live well when the world is against us if we have not first seen Jesus as the Holy Lord of our lives. The hope of Christ will never flow out of our lives and lips if it's not first in our hearts. Let me read that again. The hope of Christ will never flow from our lives and lives that's not first in our hearts. Don't have time to tell my testimony this morning, but part of my testimony talks about me, my language being a lot like the world's language, and me being apprehensive about being around other Christian men at the time. Fellowshipping a lot, and I didn't want to slip up and talk like the world in front of these guys. And what I found out was God changed my heart. He didn't have to change my speech. Because when He changed my heart, He changed what my mind was doing, and then my speech changed. So I come to find that when our hearts have changed, the other stuff kind of fixes itself. And No matter where you are this morning on your road of spirituality, each and every one of us can grow, and we can grow more mature every day. And I challenge you to do that this morning, because our families need it. Our church needs us to step up and be strong Christians. Our community our world. It starts with us. And it starts with me. We have to be growing. Miss Linda always talks about our relationship with Jesus Christ, and it's her belief that we're either drawing closer to God or we're drawing further away from God. And I agree with her. What are you doing this morning? Our last point is readiness. Once we've settled the holiness and lordship issue, we must then be ready to share with others about the hope in Christ. We don't have to fumble around for words or shrink back in fear when asked about what we believe. We can stand confidently in Christ because we have settled in our hearts and minds who He is and who we are. Peter points out the connection between a person's readiness to speak about the hope of the gospel and his view of Jesus as holy. If we hadn't set Jesus apart as Lord, we'll naturally feel intimidated about sharing the gospel. However, for those who know Jesus' power and see Him as Lord, we'll be bold about our faith. This readiness does not mean we're brash and show no regard for others' perspectives. Instead, being ready means always looking for opportunities to humbly and patiently help others to see the truth about Jesus. And I want to reiterate one point this morning, and that's back at me just as much as it is sharing with you. Our first testimony is our action. If we turn people away from God through our actions, they're never going to find Jesus. If we live our lives to be like Jesus, then people are going to want what we have. They're going to want that peace in time of trouble. They're going to want that joy when it seems like there's nothing. They're going to want that hope. But if our attitude, our actions, our words don't emulate Jesus Christ, then they're never going to come to Jesus Christ. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, thank you for the great scriptures this morning. Thank you for giving us hope indefinitely, a hopeless world, a hopeless society, or a hopeless time in our country, Lord, but us understanding and knowing that we can trust in you and have patience, peace, and joy even in times of hardship, Lord, we just thank you this morning. If there's anyone here this morning that doesn't know Jesus Christ, that they will just feel the need to take care of that this morning, Lord, and bless those that love you and thank you in Jesus' name and pray.
Thank you very much, Wade. Appreciate that. We'll take a moment to break. We're going to turn off the live streams until we're going to start right at about 10 o'clock, maybe 1 minute after with our worship time. So take a minute, stand up, stretch, say hi to somebody. We'll get started here.
Red box in the back.